It's my real pleasure on behalf of the investigators of the CardioBand study, it's the CE approval study, to present the 2 years result and give some perspectives on the future, how we will proceed using this very interesting device. So these are my disclosures. Now, the CardioBand CE Mark study is a multi-center prospective trial to evaluate the performance and safety of the CardioBand technology for repair of functional mitral regurgitation. In this trial, we have included patients above the age of 18 with moderate to severe functional MR, New York Heart classification 2 to 4, despite optimal medical treatment, including patients that also had a CRT device, if indicated, with an ejection fraction above 25% and end-diastolic LV diameters less than 70 millimeter. The patient had to undergo a heart team decision, and only if the patients were considered to be at too high risk from the heart team perspective, they could enter the trial. Now, there are some of the major exclusion criteria for the inclusion of these patients. Mostly, I should mention that patients had to be excluded with heavily calcified annuli or leaflets. And as you can see, with a pulmonary hypertension of more than 70 millimeter mercury and right-sided congestive heart failure. Well, the primary endpoint of the trial was a safety endpoint and a performance endpoint. And we measured the safety endpoint 30 days after the intervention. And as you can see, it was a combination of major serious adverse events and serious adverse device effects until hospital discharge. And major serious adverse events were death, myocardial infarct, cardiac tamponade, device-related cardiac surgery, or stroke. Now, in addition, we were also looking into the technical performance of the device for a variety of aspects. As you can see, the technical success rate, the feasibility of the adjustment of the device once the device was implanted, and of course, what the device is supposed to do at the end of the day to reduce mitral regurgitation. Secondary endpoints were very similar, measuring again major serious adverse events and device effects up to 2 years, and that's the data that I'm going to present. And then also we were looking again into MR reduction at 6, 12, and 24 months, change in 6-minute walk, and change in quality of life. These are the centers that did participate in the CE trial. As you can see, a couple of centers across Europe that were participating. And I would like to thank all the centers for their contribution to this very important first trial on the CardioBand technology. Now, the patients represent a typical group of patients with severe, moderate to severe mitral regurgitation. As you can see, the mean age was 72. More patients were male patients. The SDS score was 5. The baseline New York Heart classification showed that 86% of the patients were in New York Heart 3 to 4. Most of the patients has ischemic heart disease, and only 40% had non-ischemic dilative cardiomyopathy. The mean end diastolic diameter was 61 millimeter, and the overall ejection fraction was low at 33. And as you can see, it was ranging from 15 to 69, and most of the patients had severe comorbidities. This is a summary, what I believe is one of the most important set of data that was collected throughout the study, because it indicates the major safety events at 30 days of the trial. And as you can see, the overall number of events is rather low and very comparable to what we have experienced using the MitraClip. It indicates that the procedure, in experienced hands at least, that's what we can say at this point in time, is a very safe and reproducible procedure. There were 2 deaths at 30 days. One patient under triple therapy had a hemorrhagic stroke, one patient at the very early phase who had a detachment of the band when the anchors were still 4 millimeters only, had to undergo mitral valve surgery and finally died. There was one patient with a myocardial infarct, and in addition, there was one patient with a cardiac tamponade, which, however, was not related to the procedure, to the device itself, but due to transseptal puncture. Well, this slide summarizes the technical success of the procedure. In the total of more than 60 patients, as you can see, we were able to implant the device in 98% of the patient. So this was leading to a reduction of MR by at least one grade at discharge in 86% of the people. This is the first and only series, ladies and gentlemen, of a percutaneous direct annuloplasty device that really shows for a complete consecutive series of patients a significant reduction, not only, as you will see in a minute, of the annular diameter, but also of mitral regurgitation. And this shows the 2 years effect on the reduction of mitral regurgitation. And as you can see from these slides, in comparison to baseline, where the majority of patients either had 3 or 4+ mitral regurgitation, that there was a significant decrease at discharge, and only a minority of patients still continue to be in 3 to 4+, which were representing more or less the early experience with some patients undergoing early detachment of the device until the device has been changed to 6 millimeters anchors, where we have never ever seen a detachment of the device. And this positive effect was maintained over time up to 2 years, as you can see from this slide. Now the effect, the beneficial effect on mitral regurgitation was due to what the device is supposed to do, which is a reduction in the septolateral diameter. And as you can see, the overall reduction was from 37 millimeter down to 26 millimeter. And in most of the patients, a reduction of the septolateral diameter could be achieved. Now, this reduction was also, and most importantly, maintained over time, up to 2 years. You can see once you have a significant reduction of the SL diameter, that this reduction was the same, more or less, and there was no significant difference, whether at 30 days, 6 months, 12 months, or 24 months. Now, this reduction in annular diameter and mitral regurgitation, ladies and gentlemen, was associated with a functional improvement at 12 months for the 6-minute walk test, for quality of life, and for an improvement in the New York Heart classification. And this beneficial effect was also maintained after 2 years. Now, these are matched data from 23 patients where we were able to collect data on heart failure hospitalization 1 year before the intervention and at least for 1 year after the intervention. And as you can see, there was a reduction by 26% in heart failure hospitalizations in patients undergoing the procedure 1 year before as compared to 1 year after the CardioBand implantation. Now, there are 2 studies planned in the near future, actually. The Repair EU post-marketing trial has been started in France, will soon start also in Germany, and it will include, as you can see, a total of 100 patients at 20 sites across Europe. A very similar patient population as the one that I've introduced to you, and there is the US trial outline in more than 400 patients, as you can see, to finally look for FDA approval. So in summary, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, transcatheter surgical annuloplasty using a percutaneous approach is feasible. The safety profile is very similar to equivalent transcatheter procedure. In particular, like the mitral clip procedure, there's a significant and consistent reduction in L dimension that is shown to my own personal experience for the first time in such a percutaneous procedure. There's a significant consistent reduction in MR. And options remain open for future interventions, such as valve interventions or even a clip procedure. Now, based on this very encouraging initial experience on the mitral side, A few cases have been started, a total of three at this point in time, on the tricuspid. And I just would like to share, and all the investigators are here around the table. Francesco did the first case, Dr. van Badeleven did the second case, and we were just lucky last week to do our first case using the CardioBand in a patient with severe tricuspid regurgitation. And I just would like to show you the movie. Can we start the tone?
Not really.
Okay, there's no tone. So as you can see, this is the team. This is one of our two hybrid rooms at the St. George Hospital. The patient was a 70-year-old patient. I should mention, and that is very important, this patient, that the patient had in 2006 an implant of an aortic valve, and this implant, and please note here, you see the septal leaflet here and the anterior leaflet here, and there is a severe coaptation gap of 11 millimeters in this patient, leading to this severe tricuspid regurgitation. Actually, there was almost no functioning tricuspid valve.
The tricuspid valve is just open.
Okay, this is
insert the stable sheath that then takes the IDS to perform the procedure. I'm just introducing the sheath now to the right atrium.
The problem
so now
here
we introduce the delivery system.
The problem was the aortic valve here, which was shadowing the anterior superior part of the annulus ring.
Okay.
So this is the first anchor that we implant.
It's coming.
I should mention that the procedure is
and it
guided
makes ventricular
by
premature beats. You saw that?
Flexi slice technology.
Muscle.
Muscle man. You are the muscle man. Okay.
So we saw some ventricular premature beats, which we like to
That's
see.
Fine.
That's the second anchor. The first anchor here. The second will follow in
Release.
A minute.
So we do four clicks.
Yes.
So these are the three anchors which really go
perfect.
Together
it's
very
perfect.
Closely. Because most of the force is at the anterolateral aspect here. So you can see the entire procedure is really guided by 3D echo, and we are using this technology, which really is available with the GE, this flexi slice, which allows you millimeter per millimeter to identify the site of the hinge point. Now this is the LOO projection, and you see very nicely, we are a little bit away from the anterolateral aspect, because of the shadowing that we saw here. And now we start to cinch the annulus. So the technique that we are using is really a copy of what we do on the left, on the mitral side. We are using precisely the same technology, the same strategy to do the implant. This is now the maximum cinch that we have done at 4.5.
Okay, so I think we are done here, right? We go, we disconnect.
You see the right coronary artery, and we have to stay
so
away from
the
right coronary artery,
from
which
the implant.
Can nicely be done. So now we detach the adjustment tool.
The pulmonary artery wedge pressure and the right atrial pressure.
And look to the change that we have achieved. I mean, the right atrial pressure dropped from 21 to 10, the regurgitant volume from 76 down to 26, and the end of the diameter was reduced by 4.8 down to 3.7. So there was a significant effect.
I like that the system is safe and that we are not putting any harm on the patient. So thank you very much. Thanks to the team. Thanks to everybody for a great experience. Bye-bye.
So I just wanted to introduce this procedure because Dr. Nikanik will address the tricuspid valve at the end of the session. So I just wanted to show you the procedure is so safe that we did it, and we did with our initial case, this recording. So we were quite confident that we could do the procedure after some experience on the mitral side. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Karl-Heinz. Very, very impressive data and a wonderful outlook for the tricuspid also. The next speaker, well known to you all, great experience with CardioBand. Actually, he was the one that came up with the idea, Francesco Maisano from Zurich. Francesco, you tell us what we learned, you learned, we learned from the first 100 cases.
So it's a real pleasure to tell you my experience from a basement animal lab with stinky pigs to more than 100 patients done presented in main arena London Valves. It's a big acquisition, I think. So what I'm going to present is the result of a collaboration among several centers. In this slide, only there are only the centers who participated to the very initial trial. More than other 20 centers are involved in implantations. And now we have done more than 100 cases. We absolutely crossed the initial learning curve. We learned some lessons that I'm going to share with you. And today we have a mature procedure. However, we continue collaboration with all our friends and with the company to keep on improving this procedure, which has a tremendous potential to become a first line solution for patients with functional MR. So I think we have been already discussing this therapy enough. Most of you already are familiar with this technology. I just want to mention that this is a surgical-like annuloplasty delivered with a catheter. So this is my dream come true, that you can reproduce what surgeons do with a catheter. We learned how to do the procedure with standardized imaging procedures. We use a combination of fluoro and echo to guide the procedure precisely and safely. And the end result in the mitral space is that you are able to cinch the annulus and reduce, or in most occasions, abolish MR, like you see in this case, by means of an aggressive reduction of annular size. So how you can obtain this safely and effectively today? Well, this was a process that goes into several steps. We have encountered, as any new procedure, our problems, and we found our solutions. The first problem in the first, 10, 20 patients was anchoring optimization and durability. We had several cases where the anchors were not well placed and were not durable enough. And then we went into an improvement of the anchoring system as well as the procedure. We developed a navigation protocol which allows today to do this procedure also in inexperienced hands in a reasonable time. We improved our imaging protocol. We're still improving more and more. And lately, the device has been, the delivery system has been improved to facilitate the implantation, even in case of suboptimal transseptal puncture. I will go a little bit more in the details, starting from the anchoring. There's been an improved design compared to the very initial phase, an updated protocol for deployment, and to verify the anchoring quality. And with the longer anchors in the last 90 patients, we have seen no dehiscences. So this problem has been solved. There has been some cases in the initial phase where there was no cinching due to a malfunction of the cinching mechanism, basically due to the fact that the tensioning wire was getting entangled into the anchors. The second generation implant has been improved, and this problem has been as well solved, so we don't have seen any more cases with no cinching. The third improvement, which has been recently introduced in clinical practice, is a additional maneuverability that allows to manipulate the delivery system size and length so to reach any anatomy in any dimension of the annulus, even in case of a suboptimal transseptal puncture. In the very first initial phase, we have been struggling identifying the ideal transseptal puncture position. We then went into aggressive preparation of the procedure with pre-procedural planning with CT scan. Today, this is less of a problem due to a more flexibility in the delivery system. The echo guidance is obviously and remains today the most important step to improve the quality, the safety, the efficacy of the procedure, but also the speed of the procedure. As we all know, and we have been discussing enough, This is a procedure which is a bit more long, a bit longer than others, but with improved experience, with good imaging, in experience ends, this procedure is currently done in less than 1 hour and a half in most occasions, and very experienced operators that you see on this table can do it in about an hour. There is also standardized fluoroprojections. This is not unexpected. We have been working on understanding how to navigate with a fluoro-based approach using a guide wire to identify the position of the circumflex artery. And we have been working in understanding what are the ideal fluoroprojections to identify the target of the anchoring as well as the penetration of the anchor into the muscle. Navigation is pretty standard. You can see here on the right side a simulator that shows how just by moving one knob, you navigate almost automatically in the direction where the anchors should be implanted. There is a very standardized protocol which requires not too much inventivity to be able to place the anchors around the annulus. Last but not least, we've been learning about patient selection. I think we have been starting selecting patients according to surgical annuloplasty knowledge. As we move forward, we find out that probably in some occasions, partial annuloplasty can be even more effective than surgery, even in those patients who by surgical means are considered high risk for failure, because we have seen several patients would be not ideal candidate for annuloplasty according to surgical standards have been super responders. The big difference probably is because this device is implanted in the base of the ventricle. It's implanted in the base of the ventricle and it really has the anchors go into the ventricular muscle and have a potential for remodeling the base of the ventricle rather than just the annulus. One important feature has been the position of the circumflex artery, which is obviously one of the landmarks that have to be respected to avoid any safety issues. We have learned a lot, and we learn how to circumvene eventual anatomical burdens. We obviously have been not seeing problems with hemodynamics compared to other transcatheter mitral interventions, namely mitral clip. You don't have to negotiate between MR reduction and mitral stenosis in this case. So overall, we have seen more and more advantages of this approach, and we are ready to expand the criteria. I just have shown here one example of a CardioBand which has been implanted after the mitral clip procedure. We have also had patients who didn't respond to CardioBand who went successfully mitral clip procedure afterwards, confirming that the combination of two therapies in a subgroup of patients may be the solution to expand indication of mitral repair. And last but not least, we have seen the CardioBand tricuspid. So in summary, with 1 minute less than my allocated time, I think we learned a lot coming from the animal lab in the garage. We have been working with implanters to learn more and more, and we are still open and we still have to learn more. Technology is already today mature to be introduced in clinical practice in a larger scale. We have a very standardized procedure. All cases are proctored by non-physicians, and the training has been so good organized and optimized that I think you should be ready tomorrow to start this procedure in your practice. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Francesco, for giving us this insight and at the same time, take a lot of experience out of your pocket. Thanks very much. So the next speaker is Stefan von Badesleben. He's University of Mainz, and he will be giving us a video, I think, on the cases. You do this from here?
Yeah. Yes.
Perfect. Okay, go ahead, Stefan.
Okay, can we switch to the laptop? Thank you very much. We'll now see the CardioBand procedure. It's one of the CE mark study implants from Mainz University, just to show the ease of the procedure.
Hello, a warm welcome from the University of Medicine in Mainz, Germany.
My name is Ralf Stefan von Bartlim. We will today perform a case of functional mitral regurgitation in a 78-year-old patient with functional MR. We will employ, in this case, a direct annuloplasty using the CardioBand implantation. To my right side is Dr. Martin Geyer, who will assist me in the first part. Later, Dr. Eberhard Schulz will join me too for the CardioBand implantation. I'd also like to warmly welcome all the team members of the Valtech Corporation who are preparing the device and will help us in steering. First of all, Daniel Schekel. Also our anesthesiology team together with Mrs. Didion and of course the imaging part with Mr. Berger from the GE Corporation and the two persons at the echo steering will be Dr. Alexander Tam and Dr. Martin Geyer. So we'll now start with the first step, the transseptal puncture. The mitral ring in this case is dilated with about 4.5 centimeters in size, and we will now get to the focus with a transseptal puncture. We already did a venous puncture in the groin. We now nicely advance the whole system. You can see we get smoothly in, there's no bleeding. We have a large anatomy in this patient, so also a large atrium. So we'll try to have a little bit more bending, which is up to 90 degrees of the transseptal sheath needle. We'll now introduce the needle into the transseptal puncture sheath. The pre-calculated height of this puncture will be 3.5 to 4 centimeters above the mitral annulus, and we will also puncture about 2.8 centimeters posterior to the aorta. You can now see in fluoro that we already reached the position. I point the needle to 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and I now move back. So here we're tenting. See the tenting? You have to move a little bit. I'm still anterior. Measure the distance anterior, please. We're doing a lot of tenting. It's very nice. So we want to be 2.84 centimeters posterior. 2.85. It's perfect. Okay, we go. I move up a little bit. Now I'm more anterior. I'm in the central part of the fossa now. Look again. I moved posterior. It's all dynamic. Look for this distance to the aorta. It's better. 2.7, okay. Now show me the distance, please, to the valve. Now measure down. From that point, 4.3. I think we have to do that, okay. Give me a 45, we will puncture now. I pull out the needle. I punctured. Okay, we're through. We stick with this puncture. We now exchange for a stiff wire to get in with the system. We're across the rim. That I'm not in the left atrial appendage, but it looks nice already in fluoro. Huh? We're above, yeah. Perfect. Then we remove. Now we go in with the TS, transseptal sheath. We now come close in echo also to the transseptal area. Nice to see that. We're tenting a little bit with the dilator. I keep the system interior. I hold the wire. Got it. Thank you. And we now try to cross. I remove the dilator. We now have the stabilizer. Okay, it's secured. I can curve it. This looks already nice. I'm out the LAA. Okay, sehr gut.
Seems good.
Hope.
I understand.
So the system is now connected into the transseptal sheath.
So this
and,
is the air.
We have two manipulation sites. So one
is a 24 French sheath
wire
system.
At the tip of the catheter. It shall penetrate the LV. It's an Ironman catheter. and we have a little spool which will take up the cinching wire. So we're looking here now at the drip that shall become a little bit blood colored.
Just showing you every step, so you
Alexander,
see the banding, which is 90 degrees.
We will do this procedure
already pointing towards
the
mitral valve.
So we have to have a very nice image now of the LAA and the hinge point in a second. Okay, I'll rotate this. Okay, there we see the system. We can move back a little bit even. We're already, so now we're free, okay, across the valve. So I would now go in and
So here you see the sheath crossing, you see the banding of the sheath already, and you have a whole impression of the mitral valve. So this is one of these flexi-slice views that we'll see in more detail later.
We see it coming out. You see the sheath. Okay. Try to use flexi to see, control the tip now of the catheter. Right, that's very nice. Don't move the green line down. We see everything here, see? So I can give a little TS plus or minus to get up, yeah.
We have the aorta down here, move it up, and we can see here how the sheath crosses. You already will see in a second the LAA, so we have a nice anatomic depiction of segment one, the hinge point here. And so this replaces the surgical view completely.
Okay,
what is nice about this flexi protocol that we'll discuss later is that we can cut through the three-dimensional object of the mitral valve and the ring in any position and highlight exactly the position of the catheter, as you can see here. This gives us extreme steerability and means that the echocardiographer hasn't to adapt the angulation anymore. We do this totally virtual by the computer on the ultrasound machine. And this really helped to really improve the procedure. You see this here. I'm now pointing with the two lines to the object of interest, which is the tip of the catheter. I can see the coronary sinus, the mitral valve, and I can see exactly the angulation of 45 degrees to the muscular tissue next to the mitral ring. And this is very important for catheter control.
We're getting nearer, of course, to the circumflex and the others. Okay, not too much pressure, but I hold it.
So you see the hinge point here. You see the catheter pointing into the muscle. So we have some pressure there on the mitral ring to improve catheter stability. And you can then screw out the first screw here. As you heard before, the first three screws have been proven to be very important for the procedure, as the main pulling force is enforced in this lateral segment. So it's very important to stabilize the band next to the left atrial appendage, and this is done here. Now the first screw is released and pulled back. You can also appreciate that we have radiopaque markers inside the cardioband, and we can see the distances. These markers are about 8 millimeters apart from each other. We will now go back about 4 millimeters and deploy the next anchor.
Okay. One, two clicks forward. Yes, I heard clicks.
So every click is 2 millimeters. That's my steerability inside with the revolver, placing the anchors inside the band. The cardioband is loaded here in the catheter, delivery catheter.
Yeah. Okay, push back. Okay, looks good. See? Like this. Okay? Agree?
You can see the spool here in the three-dimensional image next to the catheter. So we control all objects here inside the ring. And you see a very nice delineation of the whole mitral ring. So this improves positioning of the catheter and speeds up the whole procedure. As you can appreciate here, we're pointing always to the middle or more to the center of the valve. So we will get one ring appreciation here, and we get the perpendicular view to the mitral leaflet on this view. This is very important to see where the mitral leaflet ends, because we have a landing zone of 4 to 6 millimeters that we can use for the deployment of the anchors.
Eins. Four. Both are moving.
Huh? Perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Ich mache. Bitte. Okay. Hm? Two clicks, three. Okay, yeah.
Here you nicely see the left atrial appendage, and you see that we're using the rim part at segment one to start with the procedure. So it's just below the aortic root on the hinge point, lateral hinge point of the mitral valve where the procedure is started. The higher you get up, the more efficient your chinching is later on for the mitral valve annulus.
Let's see, two.
You can even see the screw coming into the myocardium here in the echocardiography. So you don't only see it here in fluoro, you can also see it here in echo. And please also appreciate that we control mainly the vessels, even in the cut planes of the echocardiography.
Let's go, I hold it.
So contrast injections are rarely needed.
Yeah.
Here you see the beginning of the band. The spool is here, and you see that we're now deploying anchor by anchor throughout the ring. We'll cut in a second a little bit forward.
How can we get the overkicks?
See, it's a very smooth procedure. It's about 1 meter long deployment system for the anchors. And here at this knob, you control the distance between the anchors. So unlike the GDS system, we don't have fixed spacers between the anchor positions, but the anchor position distance can be liberally controlled, and this will also influence the chinching process at different parts of the valve. Also, if there may be a partial small nodular calcification, you can overgo this by just adding 2 millimeters or decreasing 2 millimeters of the distance of the different anchors. You nicely see that these anchors are now in parallel. So after the first two or three anchors, which are very close together, we now place the anchors quite parallel down to the annular plane of the mitral valve. And the system is all the same. You have a three-dimensional view. You see these laser lines that cut through the catheter, and the whole position is controlled by this multiplanar reconstruction or flexi-slice situation. This is the introduction of the anchors in detail. Again, you can see we control the 45 to 60 degree angulation to the outside myocardial tissue, and you can appreciate, as Francesco pointed it out, we're not screwing neither in the leaflets, but we're screwing into the ventricular muscle through the fibrous hinge points of the leaflet tissue in the ring area. And this maintains very much stability. We've also done two patients with non-compaction cardiomyopathy, and also in those, the fibrous tissue in the annular area was stable enough to maintain all anchors in position and reduced FMR significantly. So now we're approaching the end. You can see there are anchors placed. We're now approaching anchor number 9 or 10. The total number of anchors typically was 16 in our experience. So we had implantations between 15 and 17 anchors in our patients so far treated. Again, what you can nicely see is that we can control both the band and the coronary arteries, as well as the coronary sinus, in the echocardiographic analysis throughout the procedure. Okay, so this is the LAO caudal, where you see more the ring situation. It resembles this image here, where you already can see the deployed anchors coming here from the starting point, which is the left atrial appendage. The aorta is down here, the aortic bulb. This is the posterior leaflet, and we're now in the septal part, so we're now approaching the last three anchors before performing the chinching. I now use a little bit larger distances to come to the next point. You see this here. So we passed here one radiopaque marker and are just implanting the last screws into the septum. So what we do is a hockey stick that goes all the way into the left atrium and back to the septum. So we're implanting in a 360 degree reverse orientation Now the final anchors. Again, you see it's a very smooth situation. We have a drive lock here that has a screwing force, controls the screwing force like on your car with about two Newton meters so that you don't have too much force inside the muscle. And here you see the complete band starting here at the aorta and reaching back almost again to the aorta from the septal side. So we're able to cover almost the whole septum here. So it's a very complete circumference of about 70% of the mitral annulus. The only uncovered part is actually the aortic mitral junction. Last implantation. You see the tuck test, we test the stability of each anchor. And now we start to release the band. The second process of a CardioBand implantation, which we will see now, is to straighten the system here to the spool that you see up there, to exchange the system for the size adjustment tool, also called SAT. We do this now. We remove the delivery catheter. We have a wire in place which connects me to the spool. And we will now get the chinching module inside, the SAT system. You see it here. It's also connected to the 24 French sheath. We now have this wire which connects directly inside the spool. The adjustment tool is coming up. You see it here. It's like a little screwdriver. It follows this line. I'm now adjusting the sheath orientation here with the TS. See, I'm entering into the spool, connecting. Now the system is connected, and we begin the chinching process. Chinching starts with a pre-chinching of about 2.5 centimeters, which we will do now, going all across the system.
With a chinching of 1.5 centimeters.
So we now control the size of the band initially. And here you have a little window. And you see now that we're chinching 2.5 to 3 centimeters. And this is the amount of centimeters that the band is shortened. You already see it here in echo. You can now control the distances. So we have different time points where we chinch about 1 centimeter each, and we wait then 3 to 4 minutes to see the chinching effect. This is controlled by fluoroscopy and by echo. The advantage over surgical annuloplasty is that this band is individually configured for each patient. We have no stenosis whatsoever. You see a very deep slope in the pressure half-time, and we typically, as you can see here, have mean gradients that are about 2 millimeters of mercury. This is the control before and during the chinching process, and it was interesting to note that even after this chinching process of about 4.5 to 5 centimeters, we saw further reduction throughout the following days after the procedure, leading to 0 MR at the end, but I'll show you this. So you see the chinching is quite prominent here. So we were able to chinch over 25% in this case, and you can nicely appreciate here in the fluoroscopy also that now the angulation of the anchors changes. They are more stretched into the inner part of the atrium, as you can see here. They align nicely. And the chinching reduces the ring size from initially 4.5 down to 3.7 centimeters. At the end, we will see a comparison of the initial and the follow-up situation of the mitral regurgitation.
was reduced to MR1+. So I think we'll now deploy the system actually after the final reevaluation. And I thank everybody for this nice cooperative work and teamwork here. It was
the glasses that you see up here are polarization glasses. So we use the three-dimensional monitor also to check for the depth. Now the system is released, as you can see here, and we'll then check for the final echo result. We close the groin with a normal Z suture, so no closure device. So this is the annulus before chinching here, and this is the annulus after chinching. You can also appreciate this in echo in the different planes, and you see that the mean gradient is 1.85 millimeters mercury. So annular reduction imposes no gradients, especially compared to other percutaneous techniques. And you see this is 1 week follow-up, and this is a 6 week follow-up of this patient. And I think we have a trace MR in this patient. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Dr. von Badeleben. I think that everybody who's doing these procedures, also in comparison to clip procedures, would confirm that this is a very safe and very controlled procedure. The system where you are delivering this therapy with is a very, very controlled system, and you can really move step by step. I think the safety is really remarkable if you consider that these patients are very sick patients. Now, we have three questions for the panel. The first question is, do you need a surgeon in the room during the procedure? I cannot ask this Francesco, because by chance he is a surgeon. So if he's there, there's always a surgeon in the room. So I would like to answer the question, and we had a discussion in the session before where somebody was saying that for the clip we need a surgeon in the room. Again, I disagree with this. You know, we believe that these are safe procedures, provided that you get the right training, and I think this is also true now, and it was mentioned by Francesco, that the training for the CardioBand now on the simulator is and in the cath lab so well done that you really, once you go to the patient, you feel very comfortable and you feel very confident that you can do the procedure. So I don't believe that you have to have a surgeon, and the German Cardiac Society made a very strong statement that in contrast to TAVR, you don't need for this type of procedure a surgeon in the room. I think that you have to make some agreement with all these interventions with the surgical department that in case something happens, then you, of course you need to involve a surgeon. So the second question should go to Dr. Nikanik. What is the difference between the CardioBand and GDS?
No, I think the mitral clip. Let him answer the mitral clip. What's the advantage of the CardioBand over the mitral clip? Is that okay?
I wanted to give this.
So you want to negotiate first?
No.
Maybe I can go for both. GDS comes from the left ventricular side, so it's. I haven't done the procedure, but I haven't heard from the procedure recently. For the last 1 or 2 years. It comes from the left ventricular side, so you have to bend the catheter upwards, and then you have to develop the device in the annulus. And some of us have also experience with the mitral line system and know how difficult that could be, because there are lots of pockets and chordae that might be in the way. This could be a reason why we haven't heard from GDS. So difference between CardioBand and mitral clip, I mean, that's very obvious. The CardioBand aims at the reduction of the annulus. So in any patient with mitral regurgitation, which has an annular dilation, and that's usually the leading pathology in those patients, the CardioBand could be a very good option. And probably the better option than the mitral clip. And as it has referred to already, and Karl-Heinz Cook mentioned that, it leaves further option open. You can place a CardioBand in such a patient, and afterwards you could still go, if you have to at all, could go for a clip, could go for replacement, or for an open heart surgical approach.
Yeah, there's one more question. Which centers are allowed to perform this type of procedure at the moment? What are the preconditions of such centers, Francesco?
So I think I can proceed in the initially we were looking at centers with mitral experience, which obviously it's very similar to the navigation in the left atrium. On the other hand, I think after more than 100 cases, I would say that you don't need to be a mitral expert. Crazy. There is a big difference here. To perform a good mitral procedure, I think you need to have a bit of surgical background. No, I mean, you need a specific experience in mitral business. In this case, honestly, there is no need for experience. You just have to implant the ring in the right position according to the regulations, according to the IFUs, and then you have to cinch it. So really, everybody can do it. There is no preconditioning. You just have to go to the training and start.
We have another question that comes to every procedure time, and we can ask very shortly the panel. I just can mention that a few days ago I did a mitral life case with the CardioBand, and we finished really the procedure from the beginning to the very end in 1.5 hours. There are procedures, like in the clip, that can last longer, but the procedure is really very standardized now, and I think it's really moving in the right direction. Maybe all of you would like to share who are doing these procedures. Georg?
I agree. I mean, it's imaging. The procedure itself is very easy. It's all about imaging. If we have good imaging, procedure lasts not longer than 90 minutes. I totally agree.
Okay, anybody disagrees here?
Yeah, and then the last question, what is the difference or the advantages of the CardioBand compared to the Carillon device? Who wants to talk about that? Georg, we've done Carillon cases.
Some of us have done Carillon cases. I mean, the difference is that you see the effect of the CardioBand on the mitral regurgitation right away. So you have a success control right in the cath lab. You don't have this in most of the cases with Carillon. There are some data out there suggesting that there is cardiac remodeling after a while, after you have placed the Carillon device. There is a study ongoing randomizing patients, Carillon, against medical treatment, even with sham control. I think we have to wait for these data.
Okay.
Yeah, I think for time reasons, we have to proceed, and our next speaker is Dr. Latip, and he will talk about CardioBand synergetic with other treatments.
Please.
Thank you, Karl-Heinz Eberhard, and to Valtech for the opportunity to present at the symposium. So I'm going to be talking about CardioBand being synergetic with other therapies, but before I get to this synergism, I wanted to a little bit share my own CardioBand experience, because I think doing a case where it is synergetic is more complicated, and you need to start with simpler cases before. And I'm pretty sure the reason that Valtech asked me to present to this meeting, it was because of the fact, we mentioned what you need to know or do before you do a CardioBand. Well, I actually learned how to do CardioBand before I learned how to do mitral clip. It was the first transcatheter mitral intervention I learned how to do. And I thought, I'd share my experience with you, because I thought it was quite unique having to learn this device, which many would think is much more complicated than a mitral clip, at least at first glance. So I was exposed to the CardioBand fairly early. I worked with Francesco, and I saw some of the first-in-man. I was a second operator for some of the first-in-man cases. And to date, I've done 70 cases. And how long has it taken? It was long, and it's gotten better with time. I've learned the technique, and I'll show you how I've learned the technique. And I think, I did an implant a week ago. It took me an hour to put in 16 anchors. That's very different to my first implants. So how did I learn to do this? And I think part of it goes to the fact that, and I've given Valtech a lot of credit, because I think they have one of the most extensive and best training programs. So before you actually get to do the device on a patient, they come through, they have the simulator, which is very hands-on, so you put it in the cath lab, under fluoroscopy. As you see here, there's a TE probe that goes in the back. The leaflets, the mitral leaflets move, so you can get images, moving images of the mitral valve, you can get 3D images, and you can really then learn how to use the device and implant the device like you would in the patient. So using fluoroscopy and using transesophageal echo. And the images you get are pretty good. So you, this is on a model. So here you see me implanting the CardioBand on this model. You see the TE probe. And you can see on the 3D, you can actually see the device pretty well. You can get X-planes as well, able to see the hinge point of the leaflet and be able to understand where you're about to implant that anchor. So you see a full implant being done on a model. So I think that was absolutely useful for me to learn. But I think when you're doing, and here you see this is what the model looks like when you take the implant out. But I think the other thing that's really useful, one of the things I said to Valtech when I first wanted to learn how to use the device was, I think I needed a playbook. I needed to know what I needed to turn, which knob I needed to turn to get from point A to point B to point C. And I felt that in 80% of cases, or even more, in majority of cases, it would be very predictable. It should be the same movements. And that's essentially what we do have now, is you're able, as a first operator, and the company is able to teach you, you know, we started the anterolateral commissure, and we need to get all the way here to the posterior medial commissure, then now very repeatable movements of different parts of the catheter that you can learn. So you know exactly what part of the transseptal sheath or the guiding catheter you need to use to get along P1, or to change from P1 to P2, the movement changes slightly, a little bit. When you need to get from P2 to P3, again, you use different parts of the delivery system. You may need to pull the system back, you may need to use the guiding catheter. As you go to P3, and I think you saw that in the live case, you start hooking the guiding catheter more in order to be able to get very close to where your transseptal puncture was. And I think having this playbook, having this sort of, you know, guide on how to get around the annulus has made this procedure very reproducible. And I think I've seen that in my own experience with the results I've had. The other thing that's been dramatic, and I think you saw it in the live case as well, is that the support you have for your you have during cases. So I've done all my cases with this young man over here called Tomer, who's really been extremely supportive and has taught me how to use the procedure. But more than that, he's been available to come and train me every time so that I really understand how to do this procedure. The last part, I think, that has made this procedure successful to learn as an operator who hasn't performed mitral clip, I do now, but when I started doing this, I didn't, was the fact that there's a very extensive pre-procedural evaluation that is done by the company, where you really get to understand how you will manipulate this device around the annulus. So if I think about the last five cases I've done, you know, my results have increased and gotten better with time, and so my procedural time has decreased a little bit. And this was a procedure I did in March, which was a more standard procedure, and it took me probably close to 2.5 to 3 hours, and it's interesting how three procedures later, it's down now, as the other members of the panel have said, down to 90 minutes. So here you see, as you've seen before, you know, us moving across the annulus, the posterior annulus, implanting multiple anchors. And I'll just maybe move forward a little bit. And here you see the entire implant in the LAO view, the unfaced view, really seeing what the device looks like before cinching. And you'll see how with cinching, how the annular dimensions decrease. And so the results we get, this is what it looks like after cinching. You really see before cinching, after cinching, really a dramatic change in annular dimensions. And these are the kind of results we get on echo. So this was baseline, this was post-contraction. So when having had that initial experience, we then sort of go ahead and try and treat more interesting and more challenging patients. So this was a patient I treated a couple of months ago, 74 years old, previous coronary artery bypass with patent grafts. He's had previous PCI and ICD. And about a year ago, he underwent mitral clip implantation with two clips. It was noted at the time it was for functional MR, but he did have posterior retraction of the leaflets. He now presented because he had persistent dyspnea on treatment despite optimal medical therapy. His ejection fraction was 39%. He had severe MR despite the two mitral clips. And I'll maybe just quickly go forward and then go back to show you what the echo looked like. So here you see the two clips, and here you see what the echo looks like. And you see sort of these multiple jets between the two clips and on either side of the clip. So really, we weren't sure what to do for this patient. We discussed it in our heart team. I remember discussing this with Professor Alfieri and asking him what his advice was. And we all decided, let's try and do a CardioBand. He wasn't sure if it would work or not, but we thought we'd go ahead. And I'd like to share with you that case.
So I think you've seen a lot of the procedures, so I've shortened it here. It's really important to have a consistent team when you do this, to have the same echocardiographer with who you build a relationship and do the procedure. So here you see the transseptal puncture being performed, and then insertion of the transseptal sheath. Removing the dilator as you've advanced the sheath into the left atrium. It has a dedicated stand to which you attach the sheath, very similar to the mitral clip delivery system. This is the implant delivery system that has the cardioband, which is then inserted through the guiding catheter, the transseptal sheath. In some of the initial cases, we were using this Iron Man to be sure you're in the ventricle. In most recent cases, we've stopped using it. Our feeling has it hasn't really added that much to the procedure. And then we start inserting our anchors. So doing a cardioband after a mitral clip, I have to admit there were some challenges. So particularly as we got to P2 where the clips were, there was some artifact from the clips. It became a little bit more challenging in order to be able to see the hinge point. I think the other thing that was challenging that I noted during the procedure, this patient did have a posterior retraction of the leaflet. And now with the clips attached, actually the posterior leaflet around P2 wasn't moving much. So to be able to distinguish the hinge point from annulus and leaflet was very challenging. And really what we've been using a lot is the flexi slice, which really does give you a three-dimensional view of the annulus and your delivery system. So the procedure took just over 2 hours. And here you see the multiple anchors of the cardioband being implanted. We then remove the implant delivery system, and we insert then the adjustment tool that will allow us to do the cinching. And here you see the size adjustment tool, which is inserted. And we start doing our cinching. Often, another thing we've noticed, you really only start seeing a difference in the regurgitation once you get to the higher levels of cinching. So we know that for each size of cardioband, there's a different maximum amount of cinching you can do. So in this case, I think it was 4.5. And you really start seeing the difference when you go from 3.5 to 4.5. So let me just show you what the final result looked like. This is what we started out with baseline. And we decided we'd try to do a fully percutaneous repair of this valve. And that's what the final result was. It really was dramatic. It was really an excellent result. And I think a solution for patients who've had mitral clip for functional MR, who continue to have annular dilatation and come back with recurrent MR. So if you want to know more of the case, we have published this. I just want to show you one last case very briefly. And one of the things that's really been dramatic for me, this is, I think, the second last case I did. Again, really severe functional MR, annular dilatation. We put 15 anchors. When we got to 3.5 centimeters, we already saw that there was really minimal MR. There was also smoke in the left atrium, which was the first time I've seen this in a cardioband procedure. But I think having full adjustability in the beating heart means that even mild or trivial MR, you don't need to accept. So we went from 3.5 to 4.5. And you notice how we completely obliterated the MR in this case. So I think having this full adjustability of the beating heart is a true advantage. So I think for me, the take-home message, I think you can learn this procedure because it does have an extensive theoretical and practical training program. The device usability and navigation are predictable. I think what makes a difference to learning a complex procedure as well is excellent clinical support and clinical case support. Previous mitral clip experience is useful, but as I've shown, not mandatory. I do think when you think about learning a new procedure, particularly in valvular heart disease, procedural time in the beginning is not as important as the final result and really dedicating yourself to learning the procedure. I do believe that this can be a teachable, learnable, and reproducible procedure. And I think showing you a synergistic therapy of mitral clip and cardioband will probably allow us to have a fully percutaneous, complete mitral valve repair. Thank you.
Thank you, Azim. I think we discussed or we had the question, how does this procedure compare with other direct annuloplasty or indirect annuloplasty systems? And I think the major learning for me is how much cinching you need before you see some effect on the mitral regurgitation. And I think that is something that some of the other technologies completely underestimate, that you need a 30%, 35% reduction in the diameter before you can see any effect on the MR. Is that something that you would share?
Yeah, I completely agree. You know, the thing that's been dramatic for me is that, you know, like I said, sometimes you know for that implant size, you've got to go to 4.5. You get to 3.5, and you see how the annulus size has changed. Okay, you've decreased septal lateral dimensions in an important way, maybe even 20%, but you haven't impacted much on the MR. But when you go that extra to 4.5, yes, suddenly it disappears. Yeah. And I just don't think all devices can get that much of cinching or plication of the tissue.
Thank you very much. For time reasons, we have to move on, and the next presenter is Dr. von Badeleben, who, besides becoming an interventionalist, was for many, many years an echocardiographer, one of the best probably in the country, and I'm happy to introduce today his title, Echo Guidance Following the Anatomy and Physiology. Please.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and we have seen some of these things, so I'll quickly, for the sake of time, quickly run through these slides just to give you an idea how imaging makes an impact, especially on the cardioband, and to look for anatomy. So as we learned before, and this is just a summary of what you've seen before, it's a very easy procedure. It's a venous puncture, then a transseptal puncture, which is CT pre-planned, so you know exactly where to puncture. We look for three different points, and this is the distance to the aorta and the distance to the mitral valve. The TS sheath positioning is controlled under echo. We also used in the first cases the Ironman. We only don't do this anymore, and I'll show you why, because we see enough actually with flexi slice and with modern three-dimensional echo. The GC positioning is near the LAA is the primary landing zone where you implant three anchors. And you can do this without an Ironman, so this also shortens the procedure by about 5 minutes to 10 minutes. GC and anchor repositioning is done with MPR and flexi slice, and I think this is the biggest innovation that we introduced after case number 50 worldwide, and that has been consistently used in different centers. I think Bonn is using it, Hamburg is using it, and I think it made a huge advantage to the device times and the whole procedure. And at the end, echo is used for cinching and MR assessment, as we have seen in the talk by Asim Latib. So to take it with another implantation, you say that not only in very dilated ventricles we can use this procedure, but we can also use them in extremely dilated left atria, as you can see here. So this is the volume, as you can read up here, of 240 cc, so giving a massive dilatation, which is above 140 cc per meter square. The cutoff for extreme dilatation in the guidelines, the chamber quantification guidelines, is 48 millimeters per meter square. You can see the huge regurgitation, and you see the annular dilatation, which is caused by the ventricle, but more pronounced by the atrium. So what can we do in these cases? You see we get excellent image delineation of the structures. We first look for the LAA, which is actually the first anchor point in the segment one, the lateral segment of the mitral valve. We can then control in the next image. It went up a little bit too fast. I'm just getting back and forward. Okay, now it runs. You can nicely see the severe regurgitation, so we check this. Also for the distribution, and you see it's a holocommissural regurgitation, ranging from segment 1, 2, and 3. So a massive mitral regurgitation that we are now going to treat. So these are still pictures just to concentrate on. You see the tenting. This is a bicaval view. You have the view here is a four-chamber view, and this is a short-axis views. And these are the three most important decisive image planes in three-dimensional echo, which is on two-dimensional echo, the 100 degree, the 0 degree, and the 45 degree, where you get these different positions. But you can also nicely see that we see the transseptal puncture point, and here with the sheath in, already in relation to the valve and the ring. So I would highlight that we need very high imaging of the left atrium. So we begin to position the probe on a different position than for a mitral procedure, because in the mitral procedure we concentrate on the valve tissue. In this procedure we concentrate on the LA and the circular annulus tissue. So this is also a difference in imaging.
What that makes it possible actually to see all different adjacent structures like aorta, like even the wire and the mitral ring and the whole mitral valve from a very distinct perception. And I think this is another key to this procedure. You can see after exchanging this wire, we go down in the first cases with the Ironman, so I just show it to you, how we control the penetration of the Ironman into the ventricle to define the hinge point of the most lateral commissure. And this has also been done in three-dimensional echo, as you can see here. This is the Ironman catheter in three-dimensional echo. This is the end of the commissure. Here you see the left atrial appendage. So my first landing zone will be directly here. As we know this after two or three procedures, you then don't need the Ironman actually anymore. You can do without. And what we then use is just to go from the leaflet. And here you see a catheter position, which is too much into the leaflet. And we will now just move it out to the direction of left atrial appendage. And you can see that we can control it in a very nice fashion. And you can even see the vessels in this situation. Here we are at the hinge point. You see the aortic root is near. We're only about 4 millimeters apart from that point. So this is a very, very high start to the hinge point, giving us a whole circumference, as I pointed out before, of about 70% of the commissure. Then the anchors are being placed, and this is one of the advances here of this flexi-slice or multiplanar reconstruction technique that's now mostly used in all centers. And what is nice here is that you can see vessels inside. So here you can see circumflex vessels. You can see the catheter addressing the area next to it, and you see the hinge point of the P1 leaflet, which is the posterior leaflet at the lateral part. The nice thing about this technique is that it is not done from recorded loops. All your steering is live, so you can maintain this position throughout the implantation of the cardioband. What is also important is, and I just want to point your attention to this upper part, and I'll show you it in a second as a still picture, is that we're now able, in echo, to even see the penetration of the screws into the myocardium. I showed here in the three-dimensional image, and here's the cut plane derived from the situation. So we see the cardioband here. Here's the spool. You see the whole cardioband, and you see the screws entering the myocardium in a two-dimensional cut plane that is adjusted in this image here, just 1 or 2 millimeters down from the catheter position. So we have excellent control of vessels, of metal structures like the anchors, and the whole procedure, and you see that they are perfectly aligned. So this is also something that we can learn, that we can use the three-dimensional techniques in a very precise way to deploy the system. Here you see that we reached a very complete situation outside the aorta, of course, but from the left atrial appendage all the way over the whole complete septum, and we hockey stick back to a position that is anterior of our puncture to complete this ring implantation. This is the hockey stick procedure, and here we come to an end with the chinching process that you can also nicely see in echo. One of the nice things about, and I have to go back one slide, one of the nice things about actually the cardioband procedure, as I pointed out before, is that we almost have no gradients in these patients. We can control the chinching process with live three-dimensional or two-dimensional echo, and you see the free function of the anterior leaflet touching below this cardioband, and this really looks like a surgical ring implantation. So in echocardiography, you almost don't see differences. And this is a control just post-procedure, 2 days after. You see the extreme chinching situation. Also here, we reduced the ring by 30%. So concordant what the panel discussed just minutes ago. Again, you can see here that we have very, very low mean gradients and that we have a very excellent result, I would say, with a trace trivial MR or no MR in these patients. And this can also be controlled in a multi-planar view. Just to give you in adjacent to the next talk, also a view, a lot of people tell me that tricuspid valve depiction is not possible with TE, and many people in the deployment of mitral clips in the tricuspid area change between TE and TTE. And I just want to highlight in this image that we're able to also depict with this multi-flex technique the tricuspid area very nicely, and we're using the same flexi-slice protocol for the mitral as well as the tricuspid space, so a nice view into the future. I'm coming to the conclusion, dear audience, percutaneous direct annuloplasty is absolutely feasible. 3D echo allows for a direct virtual control of the leaflets, of the ring, of the catheter position, of the vessels, namely the circumflex artery and the coronary sinus. It's a totally beating heart procedure, and MPR flexi-slice allows for a controlled position and angulation of each anchor in a very precise way. So we're able to see whether we're flexing 45 degrees, 60 degrees at each position, and whether the anchors are in full parallel position. Chinching effect and gradients are controlled under normal hemodynamic conditions, and I didn't overlay my time, so I hope you're content. Thanks a lot, very much.
Let's move.
Yeah, thank you very much. So we come to the last presentation by Dr. Nikonik on the tricuspid site using the CardioBand. And I think, ladies and gentlemen, what the session tells you that you see now a variety of operators that are presenting data here. And I think this is the major move that has been done over the last couple of months, that we are moving away from the one guy who can do it to multiple people who can do the procedure in a very systematic and standardized fashion. And Georg Nikonik is one of those. Please.
Okay, thank you very much for having me. So the topic is set. Mitral is boring. Let's talk a bit more about tricuspid. It's obviously one of the hottest topic we've been discussing on this meeting. These are my potential conflicts of interest. As you all know, most of the patients suffering from a tricuspid regurgitation do have functional tricuspid regurgitation, more than 90% of the patients, and that is kind of the pathology behind this. It's not a valve disease, it's a disease of the right ventricle, and usually the right ventricle gets dilated by left heart disease, for example, by some pulmonary hypertension. That leads to annular dilatation, and at the end of the day, it leads to malcooptation of the leaflets and ultimately then to tricuspid regurgitation. And usually this dilation takes place at the lateral side and the anterior side, lateral posterior side of the valve. This is very important also for our treatment regimen. Most importantly, tricuspid regurgitation seems to drive morbidity and mortality. We know that patients are doing poor with severe tricuspid regurgitation. We know that our medical efforts are pretty limited, down to diuretics, and usually patients are also suffering from renal insufficiency. And it drives also the mortality rate. These are patients with severe TR as opposed to patients with no TR, and you can easily appreciate the level of mortalities, which is also driven by the tricuspid regurgitation and admittedly also by other comorbidities in this patient cohort. And then it is a very frequent disease. Estimates from the United States come to the conclusion that more than 1.5 million of people are suffering from a significant tricuspid regurgitation, 800,000 patients probably in Germany, and then we are not able to offer proper treatment. Only a few of these patients are being treated with a surgical approach, only 5,000 out of 1.6 million in the United States. A scenario is pretty the same in the European Union, also in Germany. And therefore, there is a big time unmet need for this type of valve disease because medical treatment is also extremely limited. And therefore, we are looking, obviously, for percutaneous treatment options for tricuspid regurgitation. And there are some techniques, and these are just a few of them, which are being explored. There are some of these techniques which reach the level of clinical studies. And let me share a few thoughts or a few data on mitral clip, mitral liner, and of course, I will focus on the CardioBand and tricuspid. This is one of the patients which we have treated with a mitral clip, one of those desperate cases. Karl-Heinz Cook just showed a case with the CardioBand, almost comparable, no coaptation whatsoever, severe tricuspid regurgitation. That is probably almost 2 years back. Nowadays, we tend not to try to treat this type of patient. But anyway, we were able to place three clips in this patient. And that is shown here. This is the placement of the clips. So I'm sorry, I have to go back one more. And this is the result at the end of placing of the placement of three clips. Here you can see the exact same image here before the procedure and after the procedure, and we reached a nice result in this patient. But this is obviously not always the case. It's an elaborate procedure, and you have to do a lot of patient selection, and imaging is of ample evidence. And imaging is more difficult than it is on the mitral side because the probe is further away from the tricuspid as it is from the mitral valve, but there are still some measures to overcome this, as mentioned during the previous talk. And this is kind of a systematic overview of the data which we have so far from the mitral clip. This is data of 64 patients with mitral clip treatment in tricuspid gathered throughout the world, just submitted this this manuscript, and here you can see, you can look at the tricuspid regurgitation, 90% of the patients with severe and massive tricuspid regurgitation, and after the procedure, only 8% left with a massive or severe tricuspid regurgitation. So it seems to be successfully applicable in this patient group. How are the patients doing? This is New York Heart Association in this 64 patients, more than 90% in New York Heart 3 or 4 before the procedure, and 30 days after the procedure, some improvement, 63% only in New York Heart Association 3. Still not very satisfying, the result, but keep in mind, these patients have lots of comorbidities. They still have left heart disease, for example, reduced left ventricular ejection fraction, and so on. There is another technique which has been pioneered mostly by Joachim Schofer, the mitral line procedure. You need a jugular access, and then you shoot this wires from the right ventricle into the right atrium. You're placing these bletchers, and then you're cinching together these bletchers. I guess you have to use two of these bletchers. There's an American study going on. 15 patients have been enrolled, and success is not known so far. We have also treated four patients with this technique, and this is one of the better patients before the procedure and after the procedure, but we were not able to cinch as much as we could do probably with the CardioBand technique. And this brings me to the CardioBand technique in tricuspid. We all know that the gold standard is a surgical approach, especially if there is anything else to do on the heart, like a CABG or mitral a valve replacement, and this is a situation here left by the surgeon, leading to a almost complete abolishment of tricuspid regurgitation. And the technique which mimics this the closest is, of course, the CardioBand technique, and you have learned about this during the previous talks already, and only a few reiterations of the system had to be applied by the very talented team of CardioBand and Valtech, and now the system is also ready to be applied on the left heart side. And you have seen already one case example, and I will share another one with you in a few seconds. And then you can place the CardioBand starting, for example, at the septal posterior commissure and going to the anterior septal commissure, leaving out, of course, the septal part in order not to risk an AV block, as the surgeon would also do in this type of procedure. There has been animal data out there, and this is animal data summarized of six animals, and here you can appreciate the reduction in the anterior, posterior, and the septolateral diameter in the tricuspid annulus by 30 to 35%, which is extremely considerable and comparable to the surgical approach, but this is a percutaneous approach. So that seems to be very doable, and based on this animal trial data,
There had been three compassionate use cases, as mentioned. The first one by Francesco, and I will share this example with you. This is a patient before the cinching of the cardioband, as you would agree, on severe tricuspid regurgitation, and after placing the cardioband, TR2 may be left in this type of patient. And there have been two additional cases, one in Mainz, and you have seen the case by Karl-Heinz Cook already from Hamburg. And if you put this data together, admittedly only three patients, but still seems to be very effective and very successful. Annular diameter reduction by more than 30% in these three patients, and also a nice reduction in the semi-quantitative data assessed over the tricuspid valve. So that is promising and encouraging. But of course, we need more systematic data. We cannot stick with compassionate use data. There will be one additional compassionate use patient this week, but then we have to go on with systematic study data. And the good news is that there will be a study out there, the tri-repair study, a CE mark study that will start very soon in France and Germany. Fortunately enough, we just got approval yesterday by BfArM, and we will lead this study together with other colleagues from France and Germany. And the patients who are needed for this trial, of course, are patients with functional tricuspid regurgitation, and they're going to be not in a very good shape as it is known for this type of patient. Primary endpoint is, of course, in this early feasibility state, safety, and then device success and reduction of TR by at least one grade, and then there is a bunch of additional endpoints which we have to assess. So let me conclude, ladies and gentlemen, dear chairman. I think tricuspid regurgitation is very frequent and seems to be associated with increased morbidity and mortality rates. Surgical treatment options in isolated TR are very limited. The mortality rates, periprocedural mortality rates, are pretty high, so we are in need of a catheter-based approach for these patients, and this seems to be very attractive, but nevertheless, it has to be evaluated in clinical studies. The cardioband, in particular for tricuspid, seems to be feasible, at least according to the three cases which we have seen. There is a significant annular diameter reduction, as we have seen it on the mitral side, and this should be also applicable readily to the tricuspid side. And you have seen already and witnessed a substantial hemodynamic improvement post-cinching. And as I stated already, the European CE mark study will be ongoing in a few weeks from now. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Georg. And ladies and gentlemen, this is actually, it was a performance, it was a parade of investigators with their experience sharing with us a very new, exciting technology, both on the mitral and in the future on the tricuspid side. So let me conclude, and can I have the slides, please? The session, the key learnings, the cardioband transcatheter surgery like annuloplasty is, as you've seen, feasible. The safety profile is similar to other transcatheter procedures. Clinical data in over 100 mitral-regurgitated MR patients show significant and consistent reduction in SL dimension, severity of MR, and clinical improvement up to 24 months. The cardioband procedure is structured, straightforward, and reproducible. And with cardioband, options remain open for other future interventions. Cardioband tricuspid first in man results are very promising. Next. That's it? Is that it? Good. Then, ladies and gentlemen, panel, thank you very much for your attendance. Thank you very much for sharing your experience with us.